Wartime New Zealand has wartime jobs for everybody. Here at the Blind Institute, Auckland, the men ply busy needles for the Navy. They're at work on an order for 400 rope fenders. The basis of a ship's fender is a sewn canvas bag, later filled with cork. Skilled hands are busy, too, on rope landing nets for special use in combat areas. The finished work, nets and fenders pile up. The skill of these men as they weave and knot the ropes over the cork-filled bags is the skill of which they can be justly proud. The day's output finished and up to schedule. To haul a casualty up a 30-foot concrete wall is an easy job to this Army ambulance squad. One man reaches the patient while the others stay on top. A special stretcher, made of cane and canvas, is lowered and the casualty strapped on securely. The long haul begins. The patient is well protected from head to foot. Three men make fast work of it. Now it's up and over. Here's another problem a field ambulance is likely to encounter in modern fast-moving warfare. Taking a patient up a steep and rugged hillside. The sergeant goes ahead to take the strain. This is going to be a tough climb, but stretcher bearers have to be as tough as any other frontline troops. Removing casualties from forward areas calls for speed as well as strength. Taking every advantage of cover, the stretcher bearers get their man to the top. And it's top marks to these boys in training for the real thing.
Getting the 1st Army ashore on the North African coast was one problem. Keeping it supplied was another. But the Merchant Navy did the job, moving into North African ports with a steady flow of munitions. On the Tunisian border, the 1st Army gathered strength to drive the Axis forces right out of Africa. Nothing stopped the Navy boys. U-boats and planes harried them. Even in port, they were not safe. But when the planes struck again, the ships hit back with everything they had. South of Tunisia, the 8th Army had its problems too. It needed ammunition. Ammunition barges followed it along the coast. At improvised jetties, soldiers rushed the cases ashore. Rearmed, the 8th Army moved forward again. The natives wished it well, and the Europeans cheered it on. For them, the day of liberation had arrived. For their compatriots, it would not be long. The RAF were right on top. At 15-minute intervals, hurry bombers and fighters swept into the sky, and they swept it clean. With no Luftwaffe in sight, they peel off for a spot of ground strafing. Over the advancing army they race, and in their path, another burning German tank. Then came the bombers, the upper millstone in the grinding of the Axis forces. 1.25 million pounds of bombs a day was their way of softening the Axis defenses. Where they led, the army followed. Between the two, the enemy began to crumple. darkness fell. People were filling the streets as the First Army moved in. For 7 months, the people had been waiting for this spectacle. As tank followed tank, they became more and more excited. They were free again. They could laugh again. They could wave flags and cheer and shout again. When the army had gone, they still filled the streets. 4 days later, the people turned out again to welcome General Giraud, administrator of North Africa. His visit signified Tunisia's reunion with the French Empire. From the cathedral steps, General Giraud reviewed units of the French and Allied armies. On Cape Bon Peninsula, the Axis armies were folding up. Burning their own tanks was the last desperate act of an enemy that had been outgeneraled and outfought. From all directions came prisoners. Some surrender at the revolver point. Some walked carrying white flags. Some rode in trucks. Some just sat and waited to be picked up. Soon they were streaming back to the prison cages. And large cages were needed to accommodate 200,000. But these were not the important prisoners. The 4th Indian Division had captured Generals von Arnim and Cramer. Von Arnim, in Topi, took leave of his captors before being taken to England by plane. Back in Tunis, the people still celebrated. The soldiers were mobbed whenever they appeared. People still flocked around them to express their gratitude and admiration. Tunisia is won. All North Africa is ours, and the people are free again. Yesterday, Africa, tomorrow, Europe.